On Health Matters Television for Life, coping with type 2 diabetes.
You have to be honest with yourself, because you're the only one that can do it.
A Spokane woman's 22-year journey to stay healthy, from the ups and downs,
you get off track, and then you have to find your track again,
to the daily victories, as Health Matters looks at life with type 2 diabetes. Right now on Health Matters.
Health Matters is made possible by our viewers, the friends of KSBS, and by Providence Healthcare.
I'm Dr. Andrew Boulay, and when my wife had a cardiac arrest, I chose Providence because I knew that everything we needed for her complex care was available, from the emergency room to radiology to the nursing staff to the specialists we needed for her care.
One great thing about working at Providence is that I have the technology and the support for our type of complex patients. I'm Dr. Carl Garabedian, and I chose Providence because here I can provide the highest level of care to children of our region.
Find your doctor online at phc.org.
Good evening, I'm Teresa Lukens. Type 2 diabetes is the most common form of diabetes, affecting 29 million people in the United States. It's one of the fastest growing diseases in Canada as well, with more than 60,000 new cases yearly. It's more common in adults, but the numbers are growing in children with the rise of childhood obesity. There's no cure for type 2 diabetes, but it can be prevented. Here with us to talk more about it and to answer your questions via email and phone calls is our panel. Let's meet them. Dr. Carol Wysham is with Rockwood Clinic. She is board certified in endocrinology and metabolism. Laurie Payne is a registered dietitian and certified diabetes educator. She works for Inland Northwest Health Services. Nicole Manus is the Healthy Living Coordinator at the YMCA of the Inland Northwest. She runs the WISE Diabetes Prevention Program. And finally, Dr. Brian Seppi is with Providence Internal Medicine, where he is board certified in internal medicine. And again, our panel is here tonight to answer your calls and your emails. It's an opportunity to take advantage of these talented health professionals. And I want to welcome all of you to the program tonight. Dr. Wysham, let's establish first what type 2 diabetes is and how it's different from other forms of diabetes.
So the main two types of diabetes is type 1 diabetes, which is basically the childhood type of diabetes where the immune system fights off the beta cells that make insulin and there's no insulin production whatsoever. Type 2 diabetes, on the other hand, typically comes with a combination of a person developing a resistance to the action of insulin, the hormone that is necessary to get the glucose from the bloodstream into the cells. They become resistant to insulin, and then with ongoing stresses by lifestyle, eating, and lack of activity, eventually the beta cells, or the insulin-producing cells, can no longer keep up with the demands. And when that happens, there's a mismatch, glucose levels go up, and then when they reach a certain level, diabetes is diagnosed.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Seppi, there's a bit of a misconception that people bring this on. In some cases, that may be the case with the obesity rates rising. But really, if you're predisposed to it, and it's in the family, you're going to get type 2 diabetes.
Yeah, and type 2 diabetes, there's a very strong genetic component to it. If you have a mother or father with diabetes, you have a 20% chance of developing it by late adulthood. And in some ethnic situations, that might even be higher than that. So the one thing that I really want to stress when my patients come in with a diagnosis of diabetes, it's not their fault, it's a genetic issue. We have patients that do everything right and get diabetes, and we have patients that don't do things right, may be overweight, may not be exercising, may not eating right, and they never get diabetes. So it's not just a disease that can be controlled by environmental factors. There's a large genetic component to it. Mm-hmm. So people just need to be aware that it's not their fault that they got diabetes, but there's ways to control the diabetes once you have it with lifestyle changes.
Mm-hmm. And much of that comes with the way we eat and how we exercise and manage our life.
Right. Because type 2 diabetes is a condition that really affects the way your body turns food into energy, the meal planning is such a powerful therapy for managing it. And that's going to look different for each person. It's a matter of trying to find the best plan and the best combination that's going to work in that person's lifestyle, that's going to help control their blood sugars. And learning about how your body utilizes energy a little bit, and then learning a little bit about foods, about carbohydrates and proteins and other nutrients and how they all work together and to keep us healthy. And it's
And with the way lifestyles have changed in recent years, more prepackaged foods, and we're sitting more and we're exercising less, is this why we're seeing a rise in diabetes?
I think it's pretty clear that that's a contributing factor, you know, as far as is the added sugars in foods and just the imbalance in and the amount of calories consumed versus how many calories we burn up. You know, it's just that that is definitely contributes.
Mm-hmm. And Nicole, your program at the Y actually tries to get to people before that process starts with an education program.
Right.
Talk about how that works.
Yeah, so the burden of prediabetes is huge. The CDC notes that there's likely 86 million people in our country. More than one in three American adults is in that prediabetes range. And if they don't address those issues, a good percentage of them will develop diabetes within 10 years. So what we know from the research is that lifestyle changes with healthy eating and an increase in physical activity, a modest amount of weight loss. So the research says 7%, which is 14 pounds for a 200-pound person, can significantly reduce by up to half the new cases of diabetes in people who are at risk.
The trick, I would think, would be finding those people and those people recognizing that they are predisposed.
Absolutely.
And then finding the programs to help them.
Yeah.
Is that the challenge that you face?
It certainly is. Only about 10% of people who are in that range know that they are. So one of the easiest things they can do is take a risk test through the CDC website, or they can go to doihavediabetes.org and take a test.
Is it something everybody should do?
I think so. Everybody should. You know, the test takes less than a minute, and it will at least indicate whether they are at a high enough risk to get a blood test with their doctor.
Well, you know, the ADA recommends that every adult at age 45 be screened once every 3 years with a fasting glucose level or a hemoglobin A1C, which is a test that gives us an idea of what average blood sugar has been. So I think everybody should be requesting that information and then knowing what the numbers mean. If their blood sugars are 100, or greater, they have abnormal glucose problems. If they go up to 126 or greater, they have diabetes. So a lot of people have had the test done and perhaps don't really recognize or haven't been told flat out they have prediabetes. But screening is very important. If you have family members with diabetes, you should be screened earlier. If you come from a non-Caucasian race, you should be screened earlier, in some cases at puberty for some of these kids. So screening for diabetes is very important. I agree with doing the test, but it should be part of a routine care for an adult.
What kind of things are on the test that's asked by the CDC?
Yeah, so BMI, so anyone who has a BMI greater than 25, that's a significant risk factor. A woman who's had a baby more than 9 pounds, that's a risk factor. Individuals who are under the age of 65 but over the age of 40 and are not physically active. So each question has a number of points attached to it, some greater, some less. As Dr. Seppi said, if you have a parent with diabetes, that's going to score you some points. If you have a brother or sister with diabetes, that as well. So it takes a look at both genetics and lifestyle factors, and people get a sense whether they're at low risk or medium risk or high risk.
Mm-hmm. Are there symptoms?
There are symptoms. So if people are very thirsty or they have to go to the bathroom a lot, that can be a symptom, because with the elevated glucose in the bloodstream, what happens is that gets pulled into the kidneys, and that makes you go to the bathroom more, and then that will make you thirsty. So those are the two of the big symptoms. Some people get vision changes with diabetes. When somebody's diagnosed with diabetes, especially if they have fairly high blood sugars, I always warn them that you shouldn't go out and get a new set of glasses right away, because as we bring the blood sugar levels down, that can change the vision, and they'll have to go back through the process again. You know, one of the things that Nicole was talking about in terms of trying to get these people in early, the term we use is trying to get upstream of the diabetes epidemic. If we can get people doing the right things early, especially if they're at risk for diabetes, that's when we're really going to be able to stem the tide of diabetes. So Nicole's programs and Laurie's programs are very important, and we need to try to get those risk assessments out so that we can really help in terms of decreasing the trend and decreasing the amount of people with diabetes.
You mentioned, Dr. Wysham, the age 45. Mm-hmm. As a patient, is it up to me to ask for that test, or will my doctor recommend it?
Well, you know, it's really quite common for people, especially in their 40s to 50s, to not really have a lot of contact with the healthcare system. Mm-hmm. And many women, they might be getting their mm-hmm. healthcare, their primary care through their OBGYN. And yes, I think it is appropriate to ask, have I been screened for diabetes and what is my number? And to know that if it's 100 or greater, there is an issue there. I also wanted to point out that although it's not in the risk scores, just having hypertension, high blood pressure, mm-hmm. or having high triglycerides, low HDL cholesterol, those are risk factors that are associated with insulin resistance and identify people who could even be at risk of developing prediabetes, and you have the opportunity to intervene even before their blood sugars become abnormal. So just recognizing those risk factors as well is important.
Mm-hmm. And of course, it can't be cured, but it can be managed, and much of that comes with food, as we mentioned.
Right.
So you're probably one of the first people that patients will want to see to start that process.
Right, and when they, even when they come to see me just to learn about their diabetes, that's one of the first questions they have is, what am I supposed to eat? You know, they've heard about carbs, they don't know whether they should eat them or not eat them or how they should eat them. And where I usually start is before we even get into what to eat is how to eat. And what I mean by how to eat, I'm talking about timing of meals, when you're eating, and portions. It's all about how much you eat at one time. Because type 2 diabetes affects the way you metabolize food, and you can't really process a lot of food at one time, especially a lot of carbohydrates, doesn't mean you don't need it. Our bodies still run on sugar. We need carbohydrates. It's a matter of trying to eat it in such a way that our bodies can process it. And so I start with just sometimes you're not eating the wrong things, or it's a matter of when are you eating them and how much are you eating. Sometimes we just rearrange things, redistribute them, and that can make a huge difference.
Mm-hmm. You use a lot of visuals then to help patients sort of get a grip on this complete lifestyle change that they have to embrace?
Well, we do. When you're a dietitian, you've got all kinds of visuals. We got food and we got food labels, but we also just talk about, when do you eat breakfast? Do you eat breakfast? When do you eat lunch? And kind of lay out a routine that they can develop for themselves. And that there is innumerable combinations and plans that can work. There's not like one set of rules that somebody has to eat. You don't have to eat snacks between every meal. That's not required at all. But, you know, it's eating once or twice a day doesn't work very well. And
so it's a learning process,
right,
definitely, especially for people who have been used to maybe eating more than they should and the wrong types of foods at the wrong times.
So we just start with where they're at, and we start working towards learning how their body can process and how what they're eating is affecting their blood sugars. Start testing before meals, testing before and after a meal, so you can see what is the effect of that meal on your blood sugar.
Mm-hmm. Talk about the testing process. of going through that, because that's new for people as well to have to test their blood sugar.
Right. So the only way accurately that we have of knowing what the blood sugar is by testing the blood. So that's usually a big hurdle that patients have, is in terms of they don't want to have to stick themselves and test the blood. But you know, when patients start doing it, it's not as onerous as they usually imagine it's going to be. It's almost like brushing your teeth in the morning. You do a little stick, you put it in a machine, and it gives you your level. And the reason we do it early on in type 2 diabetes is not because we're changing a lot of medications from day to day because what their blood sugar are. It's the educational component. They get to see that, oh, if I had this chocolate donut, my blood sugar is going to be really high. But if I had an apple instead, my blood sugar is not going to be as high.
I want to just emphasize something that Dr. Seppi said, and you talk about lifestyle, mm-hmm. and I think one of the most important messages that people need to know is that lifestyle is the foundation, but that diabetes progresses over time. Those cells they become less and less able to make insulin, and so medications are almost always needed at some point. And the, you know, all of these books that say you can cure diabetes and, you know, if you just did it right, if you just did diet and exercise, leaves a lot of people feeling guilty that they're not doing it right because they need medications. And so I really want people to know that the medications are there to help, you know, make them healthier and help to make up for what their pancreas is unable to do. They're not mm-hmm. making enough insulin.
Well, and you mentioned earlier that technology is playing a big role now too, that it's becoming easier for patients to get a handle on controlling their and managing their type 2 diabetes, mm-hmm. that there are some technological advances that are helping with that.
Oh, everything from apps on phones, which can help them track what they're eating, and they can track their blood sugars and their blood pressures, and they can do blood pressures on their, you know, with their app, with their phones now, to the blood testing that we were talking about, and allowing them to learn what different things and the effects they have on their blood sugars. And, you know, we have patients who proceed through and even need insulin, and some of them are using insulin pumps and sensors where they can have continuous measurement of their blood sugar through something that they insert and wear on their bodies. And so the technology in diabetes is fascinating. It's really coming a long way.
Nicole, we find so often here on Health Matters that the group therapies seem to work great for people. Is that the case here with your clinics at the Y?
Absolutely.
That people working together will bond and share information. Mm-hmm.
I think that is the most powerful aspect of the program. There is content delivery, so a trained lifestyle coach is addressing topics and giving some information at each session around healthy living and physical activity, stress management, depression, a lot of the things that go along with trying to make major lifestyle changes. But the real power is the group itself and the ways in which even someone just discovering that others are dealing with the same struggles, that they're not alone in that. And when they can bounce ideas off one another and the group brainstorms and they help each other problem solve, that's so much more powerful than anyone telling them what to do. Mm-hmm. So they're really able to make stepwise changes over a year's time and support one another through that process all along.
Mm-hmm. Well, and then the Y has other programs that can help support the exercise component, and they can kind
Absolutely.
Of one-stop shopping.
Absolutely. Yes, and that's one advantage that the Y has to other organizations that offer the same program, because it's the CDC's National Diabetes Prevention Program, and there's lots of organizations that do it, but to be able to provide them with Y membership during the course of the program and to provide them access to wellness coaches that can help them get started in a safe way, especially if they don't have a history of exercise or maybe haven't done it in a long time and don't know where to begin mm-hmm. or how to get comfortable, they get that support along the way.
Talk about the exercise component. How important is it? We know for overall health it's important, but in this case with type 2 diabetes.
It's very important. So, you know, we talk a lot about diet, and that's an important part of controlling somebody's blood sugars as they're going up. But the other side of the equation is exercise, which burns off the blood sugar. And people that can just exercise moderately, 20 to 30 minutes a day, walking or moderate exercise, it's been shown to really help in terms of keeping their blood sugar down. The other thing I wanted to piggyback on, Nicole, was with getting diabetics together, we found to be very helpful. We're piloting a program at Providence Medical Group where we bring patients in, 10 or 12 patients, and do a group visit rather than an individual visit. And it's amazing how much they learn from each other. You know, whether what to do when they go out to eat, somebody didn't, you know, they don't like water, but they don't want to drink a Diet Pop. So somebody, another patient said, oh, I just take some Crystal Light and put it in the water, and that way I don't feel like I'm having to get a sugary drink or something like that. But that's an example of how patients are really good at teaching each other what is good and what's not good.
Maybe more likely to share that information with each other than to ask the doctor about it, or be embarrassed to ask the doctor about it.
And I didn't, you know, they come up with things that I didn't even think about, like taking Crystal Light to the, I've never told somebody that, but it's a great way of solving that one person's problem. And somebody else already had that and solved it for them.
Mm-hmm. Laurie, you mentioned that one of the biggest questions you get, and you mentioned it briefly, was on carbohydrates. And I think for all of us, that's one of those overwhelming food questions, and especially for type 2 diabetics.
Right. Well, carbohydrates, the definition of carbohydrate is really, it's just the part of any food that when we eat it, it's broken down by the enzymes to different sugars. And that is necessary to be able to absorb it into the bloodstream and be able to use it for energy. And so essentially all these different carbohydrate foods, which is a huge group of foods, it includes all the fruits, milk, yogurt, all the starches, potatoes, bread, cereals, tortillas, beans, you know, all the desserts. It's just, most of the grocery store is carbohydrate. And that's where we get our energy. But being that we, you know, with type 2 diabetes, you have a reduced amount of insulin power and reduced amount of insulin, that's going to affect how fast and how well you can process a meal. And so we at the very beginning usually start talking about an amount of carbohydrate to try to eat at different meals and snacks. And the reason we do that is because it allows a lot of flexibility and variability and choosing what foods you want to eat on different days, because that's just what is necessary and what's going to happen. And so, but if you have a carbohydrate meal plan that gives you some guidance on how much carbohydrate to eat at different meals and snacks, that can be a very powerful way to help control the blood sugars.
Mm-hmm. So we often hear good carbohydrates and bad, but there's really no such thing as a bad carbohydrate, is there?
I try to avoid labeling foods as inherently good or bad, but if I was going to do that, you know, I would, you know, the carbohydrate is part of a food, is just the part that breaks down to sugars. So a food, we got to learn to look at foods as a whole, you know, and we need, I mean, that's just one carbohydrate. Hydrate is just one nutrient. We need lots of nutrients in order to maintain good health and get the nutrition we need. There's lots of vitamins and minerals and fiber and all kinds of other things that we get from foods. And so if I was going to say a food is a good carbohydrate, it would be about the other things that are in that food besides the carb. It's, you know, if you have something like an apple or a glass of milk. Yes, there's a carbohydrate in there, but there's also lots of other nutrients. So you want to make your carbohydrate foods count for something good that you're going to get, you know, some other good nutrition out of.
Okay, we have a phone call coming in from Sonia here in Spokane. Hi, Sonia.
Hi.
You have a question for our panel?
Yes, I want to find out. I'm a diabetic. How high is my blood supposed to be? I mean, what is it got to be?
So that's a very individual answer. It depends upon how old you are, how long you've had diabetes, but we typically try to target the fasting glucose that is the first thing in the morning between 80 and 130, and then before you go to bed, somewhere between 100 and 140. But if you're older and you've had longer standing diabetes, sometimes we bring those numbers up 20 or 30 points in order to keep you safe so that you don't have problems with low blood sugars. But those are the recommendations for targets for most patients.
Is this a specific question then she wants to discuss with her healthcare provider, her doctor?
Well, yes, I think it very, you know, not being able to mm-hmm. know the history, mm-hmm. I can't give the specifics, but I think that's a very good idea, is to ask your doctor what they think your best blood sugar range should be.
Okay, and we have Julie here in Spokane with a question. Good evening.
Hi, good evening. Could you please address smoking and that it does have an effect on your blood sugar levels, even if it's a small amount of smoking?
Yes, that's a very good question. Dr. Seppi.
So smoking itself, the biggest danger with smoking and diabetes is you're putting gasoline on the fire. Diabetes puts you at risk for vascular complications, and smoking also does. So anybody that smokes and has diabetes, they're just compounding the complications that can arise with diabetes. I'm not sure how much nicotine or tobacco actually affects blood sugars themselves, but we definitely counsel patients not to smoke because of the increased risk of vascular complications that arise.
So some of the effects of smoking to cause vasoconstriction can actually decrease the delivery of nutrients to the tissues. And so there could be a decrease in the ability of the body to clear glucose if they happen to smoke, and you know, right after having a meal, it may slow down how quickly the glucose gets eliminated or gets transferred into the cells. Mm-hmm.
And is that also part of the program that you teach, is to obviously avoid smoking?
It is not a particular part of the curriculum, no. But as we work with people on the behavior changes that are important to them, sometimes that kind of thing comes up. And again, the lifestyle coaches who have a lot of skill in working with people on behavior change in general can support them in the changes that will support their overall health while they're working on the specific changes that are targeted in the program.
Okay. We have another email, this one from Jim in Alberta. And Jim says, I've been diagnosed as pre-diabetic. I test my blood sugar every morning before breakfast, hoping it is a 6.0 reading. Is this a good number? Should I test at different times? I assume during the day.
This is
millimoles.
So this is millimoles. We have to think in milligrams per cent. So that's about 108 in our measurements. So that would be considered still an elevated glucose, but is still a pretty good glucose to have. I think it's very helpful, as Laurie said, for a person who has prediabetes or diabetes, if they are testing, that they test themselves and see what happens if they eat a particular type of food or amount of food. So testing 2 hours after you start eating is when you expect to see the peak blood sugar. Normal should be less than 140, and if it is running above 140, particularly if it's a 180 or higher, you need to be, and let's see, that would be 10 or higher, then you would want to think about what you ate and maybe make it a smaller serving size or something that has a little more complexity in terms of the carbohydrates.
So there's a little trial and error involved.
It is definitely a trial and error, and that's where testing, when a person is interested in finding out what they can eat, that's how they can find out by testing to see what the impact the food has on their blood sugars.
Okay. And write it down. Keep a journal. Start a journal with what your blood sugar is, say before lunch, what you had for lunch. 2 hours later, write down what happened. Do that for a few days. You test some dinners, test breakfast, when you go out to eat, and just start looking for patterns. And it's just learning what the glycemic effect is of what you're eating on your own blood sugar. That is what is relevant to you.
So you have to learn to be a part of this process. You have mm-hmm. to be part of how your doctor is treating you.
Exactly.
Be a part of the process.
Mm-hmm. Yep. You know, one thing I'd like to add to that is that when patients come in and they get diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, one of the things they always ask, okay, where's my diet? I want to know what mm-hmm. I eat for breakfast and mm-hmm. lunch and dinner and every day, like they're doing an Atkins diet or some other mm-hmm. type of diet. And then I have to tell them, well, what this is a lifestyle change. This isn't a specific diet where you're going to eat a specific food at a specific time of day. I'm going to send you to Laurie, mm-hmm. and Laurie's going to go through what are the things you need to think about when you're eating, what are some of the foods you need to maybe avoid mostly, but it's more of a lifestyle. It is not a specific diet where you are eating a food, breakfast, lunch, and dinner type thing.
Right.
Is that right?
Right.
Well, we have mentioned that type 2 diabetes, there is no cure for it, but it can be managed with diet, exercise, and medication. Mm-hmm. And as one Spokane woman showed us, the key to her success has been in the determination to stay healthy.
This is part of Marianne Forcier's daily routine.
I'm supposed to do it four times a day.
Poking her finger and checking her glucose level using a blood glucose meter. The number on the meter helps Marianne regulate her diet so that she can manage her type 2 diabetes. Marianne was diagnosed in 1994.
I think I was sleepy a lot and started to get thirsty. And the Diet Coke and the Coke wasn't helping.
She changed her diet and worked to stay active. It was tough at first.
I don't think it's hard for me now, but early on, yeah. But then you have to have that mindset when you want to get out of this situation.
It's that spirit that keeps Marianne going.
You have to be honest with yourself because you're the only one that can do it.
In 2007, her doctor put her on insulin. 5 years later, an insulin pump. Each change came with a new challenge.
You get off track, and then you have to find your track again.
Marianne also relies on the support that she gets from Laurie Payne, the diabetes educator who's been by her side through much of this 22-year journey. At age 77, this grandmother of 13 stays active.
I am mowing my own lawn and shoveling my own walks.
And despite some struggles, she's optimistic.
Yeah, I think I do pretty good.
And Laurie, is it rare for you to work with patients for the amount of time that you've been working with Marianne? That's quite a relationship.
Well, when she was first diagnosed, she came to our Diabetes Education Center and went through the classes and learned about diabetes, and then I did not see her for quite a few years, and then she started coming in again. By that time, she had started insulin, and even though she was working really hard with that and counting carbohydrates and following the meal plan and taking insulin, it really was, she wasn't getting the results that she really wanted, so we started talking about an insulin pump, and she started on an insulin pump, and it has just worked so beautifully for her. She just has the best attitude about her diabetes. It does not rule her life. It has not taken over her life, but at the same time, she takes care of it. She is consistent with it. She tests her blood sugar. She eats three meals. If her blood sugar is high, she takes the insulin so that consistently bringing it back down again, and it has worked really, really wonderfully for her.
And she doesn't appear to be allowing that stigma that some patients
right.
feel. She's taking control, and she's just going to do whatever that next stage or step
That's
needs
right.
to be.
Right.
Which
right.
is the attitude.
Exactly. So she's progressed through all these different therapies and just made the necessary adjustments and enjoyed life all along the way.
13 grandchildren. Good for her. Yeah. Well, we have an email from Abdul, and he has an interesting question in reference to the Indian culture. He says, in Indian culture, it's believed that blood gets sweeter in a diabetic patient and that they need bitter food to cure it. Is this true?
Well, I would think it might be true in as much as eating a bitter food, you're avoiding eating something that
sweet.
Has sweet, yes. So one of the things in India, I know that the average amount of their calories that are coming from carbohydrates is in the 70 to 75% range because many of them are vegetarian. And because of the fact that they're eating such high carbohydrate foods, then yes, if they can substitute something that is not high in carbohydrate, then that is going to obviously help them control their blood sugar. But it's not like it's a balance. So you put, you know, a little bit of this and a little bit of that and they cancel each other out. It's not that. It's just a matter of finding, you know, a food that isn't high in carbohydrate that you can get energy from that isn't going to raise the blood sugar.
So there's a skosh of truth to that.
Yes, probably.
In the way it's worded.
Yeah.
Talk about the child component. We are seeing a rise epidemic-wise as far as obesity among kids adding to this problem. How do we tackle this? Where do we even begin to bring those numbers down?
Well, the most interesting thing from my perspective is that a lot of what happens in terms of risk for obesity is determined before the child is born. There are some genetic components. There's also what we call epigenetic components, what happens in the exposure in utero when they're in the mother's womb and what she's eating and what her blood sugars are doing, et cetera. So really, when it comes right down to it, I think trying to avoid childhood obesity starts with making sure that women have good prenatal care and good dietary education to know what's appropriate things to eat, screening for diabetes in those high-risk individuals, and then, in turn, helping to educate the family on what a healthy lifestyle should be to prevent obesity from happening in the first place.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, we have an email coming in about that. Tiffany from Post Falls says, my diabetic child will start a new school this fall. What do we need to discuss with the school to make sure that she's going to be okay in that school?
Laurie, have you been involved in any of the education programs with the schools?
I haven't worked directly with the schools, but I do know that it would be, you know, definitely need to go and meet with them and set up a plan so that, you know, everything is arranged ahead of time as far as knowing, as far as testing blood sugars, insulin doses, you know, food. I mean, all of that can be, you know, so that everybody's working together and knows what to do.
The Spokane schools have a very strong mm-hmm. education program for teachers and it's voluntary, but they mm-hmm. do every year meet at least once in a large group to learn about diabetes. And there are forms that are specific for each child that their healthcare professional fills out to, you know, what their doses are, what their testing is, mm-hmm. what the limits, what you should do if the blood sugar drops below this or gets above that. You know, in some cases, there's a person in the office that's being delegated
right.
to supervise mm-hmm. the testing mm-hmm. and administration of insulin if it has to be given in the school. So my suggestion is that the parents meet with the school, you know, somebody from the office and learn what they need to do to prepare their child for school and get the right information for the school.
Mm-hmm. And Nicole, I know that your program is for adults,
okay.
but do you get parents that are there to make sure also that the whole family dynamic is changing to be more healthy and to stop the progress of type 2 diabetes?
Certainly.
Slow it down, yeah. I should say.
Yeah, a lot of adults who are in the program and have kids, what they're trying to do is make lifestyle changes that are going to be shared by the whole family because they're at risk. They know that if lifestyle factors put them at greater risk, that those lifestyle factors are often shared by others in the home. Mm-hmm. And the changes that they can make and model and do alongside their spouse and kids, they're going to also have a much higher rate of sustaining those changes. Mm-hmm.
And making those lifelong changes for those children as they become adults and then change the cycle in those families.
Absolutely.
But importantly, as you point out, if the parent has prediabetes or diabetes, that child has the genetics for it as well. And so I like to emphasize to all of my adult patients that, you know, they should encourage their children to be screened for diabetes, perhaps even at a younger age, because they know they're at higher risk.
Mm-hmm. And not only screen, but try to work in factors that will decrease their risk of diabetes in terms of exercise and diet and all those
right,
type
right.
of things, mm-hmm. so that they can hopefully help that that child not develop diabetes when they're older.
Okay. We have Martha with a phone call this evening. Hi, Martha from Spokane.
Hi there.
Hi.
Hi. I know this is about type 2, but my granddaughter is type 1, and it came as a big surprise. She's a teenager right now, but now I don't want to interfere too much with what my daughter and the family are doing, but I've often wondered if she shouldn't just give up bread and crackers altogether and live a lifestyle with just other really healthy foods and give up these processed foods, these processed carbs. And but my daughter believes that she should be able to eat as much of anything so she feels like she's like any other person and that she can, you know, eat these crackers and bread and things like that, that, you know, everybody eats. And so I'm just wondering what your take might be on that. Also, I'm wondering, I bought that book by Dr. Bernard, I think, and I just wonder what you think about that, too. I haven't looked at it yet, but just wondering. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Martha.
So her granddaughter is just like every other person, except that she doesn't make insulin. And they and so what the body's not doing anymore, we're just taking care of externally. And so she can still eat cereal and bread and crackers and other foods because those are carbohydrates. I mean, we need carbohydrates. It's a matter of balancing those foods with the insulin so that her body can get the benefit out of it and utilize it. And that's what I'm sure that they're learning and how to do and doing. And because it's not really realistic to expect someone to not eat bread or it's not necessary.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And mom being concerned that she doesn't want her daughter to feel like she doesn't fit in with the other kids, and that's probably fairly common.
It's still really appropriate for us all, for you, for me, for all of us in this room, to be thinking about healthier alternatives when we're choosing our foods. And so when there's a snack that might be crackers, you know, I think there should be availability of fruit or healthier forms of carbohydrates. But, you know, not to the point where you're just saying, no, you can't have it, but, you know, making sure that the child knows what the alternatives are and encouraging them to eat healthier.
Mm-hmm. Grocery shopping can be tricky, but part of this process, because going to the grocery store, it can be overwhelming anyway, and we know that product placement isn't always where the healthy, you know, you're not always seeing those healthier foods or those better choices for type 2 diabetics.
Yes, one of the things that we talk about is learning how to interpret food labels and looking for the key information and not being,
taken in
by all of the stuff on the front of the label. It's learning how to make that evaluation
Do you suggest to patients that they start in the produce section of the store and start filling up the cart there, or are there some tips and tricks to shopping that can kind of help?
What I encourage is getting a balanced diet, and I'm always starting with where they're at. You know, it depends. You know, if I'm talking to somebody who loves vegetables, yes, we'll talk about produce and vegetables and roasting vegetables and on different. But if I'm talking to somebody who, you know, corn and potatoes is pretty much as far as they go with the vegetables, then there's no point in spending a lot of time talking about that. I encourage people to work in as many variety, as many nutrients, talking about the different food groups, proteins, dairy, fruits, vegetables, fiber. But I don't give somebody a list of these are the foods that you need to eat to stay healthy.
And as we've been discussing, it's different for everybody in terms of what they need.
Right. So tricks, people going out to eat, that's the other thing
that's
that is
another
very
tricky one.
Difficult, because portion size is such a big deal.
Going out to eat, there are some things that I will suggest and remind people about. One is when you go to a restaurant, is talking to the server and asking about substitutions. If, you know, maybe if something states that it comes with on the menu with French fries or potatoes or something else, talking to them about what else have you got back there? Do you have some other vegetables that you could substitute or some salad that I could have in place of that? And a lot of times they're more than happy to accommodate you. You don't need to offer any explanation as to why that's your request, other than that's the way you would like your meal served. And sometimes, you know, you can ask for, you know, I have a lot of people that tell me that they split meals, or they ask for take-home boxes to come with the meal so that they can separate some of it out ahead of time. And that, because if a plate of good food sits in front of you for very long, eventually you're just going to eat it all, no matter what your intention is.
So just put it in the box and set it aside. Yeah, that's a
brilliant.
Start right there. Yeah, that's a great tip. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We have Alex from Edmonton with a question. Hi, Alex.
Yes, hi. I'm a number two diabetic. Blood sugar usually in the morning is between 8 and 9. And I work more than I take carbohydrates or any protein in myself than I should do. And I'm on called metformin. I don't know if I'm supposed to say this thing. Yes. I'm 61 year old, and I would like to ask you what is recommended to gain weight. Any herbal teas, any help, any other remedy? These, you know, for 61 year old, you know, it's. I work more than I eat. No appetite, no nothing, and I'm drinking in the weekends when the body is coming over, and then I don't want to refuse them. So, can you give me any suggestions, please?
So my first suggestion would be to talk over your glucose control with your provider to find out if you are meeting what your goal should be. Your numbers are high in the morning. You know, it's a better number to be under, you know, 7 or 7.5. So I would suggest talking to your provider. If you were to take additional medication, if it was appropriate, to lower your blood sugar to a lower number, that would help you utilize the sugar in your blood and would actually help you put on weight. So I think just getting better blood sugar control is really important. I don't have any knowledge of any herbs for weight gain. I'm usually trying to get my patients to lose weight, so I haven't really focused on that aspect. I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
Well, every once in a while I will run into somebody who's really trying to, you know, needs to gain weight and is struggling with a poor appetite, and we usually talk about high calorie foods or sometimes meal supplements like Ensure type products that we can use to get some additional protein and calories. We talk about nuts and peanut butter and eggs and cheese and and oils, and those are all very high calorie foods and also have nutrients too.
What about the alcohol component?
I missed what he said about
that. I believe
that.
He said that he had his buddies come over on the weekends and that he was drinking some alcohol and wondered about that component.
Well, the alcohol can definitely affect blood sugar control. You know, that can, the alcohol itself doesn't turn to sugar, but it can affect the glucose metabolism, and it can increase insulin resistance, which is, of course, a core problem with type 2 diabetes to start with. So, being very, especially with blood sugars being not where you want them to be, very minimal on alcohol, I suppose, would be a good idea.
It's recommended no more than 2 servings at a time for a person, for a man, 1 for a woman. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the carbohydrate content that comes from some of these microbrew beers can be incredibly high. You know, they can be 400 calories for a serving, and that, of course, can raise the blood sugar significantly. But I think for weight gain, your recommendations, watch the cheese, though, because saturated fats are not good for your heart. Plus, they raise the blood sugar response to meals. So trying to stay away from those animal fats or minimize the intake of animal fats, because that also will raise your blood sugars. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Seppi, talk about what happens if you have type 2 diabetes and it goes untreated or unchecked, some of the things that can happen.
So the big things that we worry about in terms of diabetic, with diabetes, is the complications that occur. So diabetes in itself, a high blood sugar in itself, unless it gets very high or low, isn't extremely dangerous right at the moment. But over time, what happens is you get vascular complications. So the main things are it increases your risk of heart disease and heart attacks, strokes, vision problems because of vascular problems in the eye, and kidney disease. And then also it can decrease the blood flow to the limbs, so you can have problems with the nerves and get numbness. And in very extreme cases, you get your limbs lose function, so you have to do amputations. So the reason for controlling the blood sugars is to try to head off all these vascular complications that occur down the road. And getting to know that and knowing that you're doing something right now that's going to help your health in 5 or 10 years from now. So like the person on the video, you can lead a very active life in your 70s and 80s and maybe even 90s to 100s. That's the thing that we're trying to do, that we're trying to prevent those vascular complications from occurring.
Mm-hmm. And the statistics show that it's working. I mean, we have turned the corner in terms of the marked reduction in the risk for heart attacks and strokes, amputations, renal failure, blindness. So all of the complications of diabetes with good care, they're not happening as frequently as they did, say, 20 years ago. But they have to know that, just as Dr. Seppi said, you're investing in your future. It's like saving for retirement. It's hard to do now, but it's worth it in the end, because if you get out there and you haven't taken care of yourself and you start experiencing the complications, then it's almost too late. Mm-hmm.
And that's where your program comes in at the Y, by catching it early. Is it a light bulb moment for most people when they realize that they can get a handle on this and control it and live a long, happy life?
It really is, and I think particularly because many people have tried many times and in many ways to lose weight, right? And so that's losing a modest amount of weight and increasing physical activity and being able to sustain that over the long haul are really the goals of the diabetes prevention program.
It's more attainable.
It is attainable, and because it's done in a stepwise fashion, and they learn that it's not about a diet, it's not about a quick fix, it's not about someone telling them this is what you're gonna do. It's about learning skills and strategies to be able to manage all of those challenges that they face in life, that we all face, and being able to do that in a sustainable fashion. That's the light bulb moment.
And typically, how long does that process take? Is it different for everyone, or will they, before they know it, be living this different lifestyle that's just second nature?
Yeah. It is different for everyone, but the program is a year long. And it's 16 weeks of every week, and then it's every couple of weeks, and then it goes to once a month for the last little more than half of the program. So people are going to make the significant changes in a stepwise fashion over the first 6 months, but getting the support to continue that so that they feel success in the maintenance aspect of it as well, and continue to get some of that group problem solving and the support from a lifestyle coach for a long enough period of time that they feel like, yeah, I've got this.
Until, basically, right? Until, okay. We have an interesting...
We just heard this week that the Center for Medicare Services is considering covering the cost of the program that the YMCA delivers. So we are very excited about that possibility, which will extend the availability. Once Medicare starts covering something, generally the rest of the health insurance companies will follow suit as well.
That would be a nice trend, wouldn't it?
Yeah. And there are a lot of people in our community already whose health insurance covers it. So really anyone who gets their insurance through the Public Employees Bureau, so state employees or a lot of other groups who are whose insurance is purchased there. United Healthcare. So there's about 10,000 people in our community.
It's worth checking your insurance then to find out.
Yes,
absolutely. I want to sneak one more question in here as we get closer to the end of the show, because it's an interesting one from Enrique in Red Deer, Alberta. Are there herbs and supplements that will help or hurt a diabetic? A lot of people like to take supplements and, you know, think that it's helping their health, but in some cases, can it actually be hurting?
I think, you know, there are some supplements, I can't remember all of the names of them, there are some that are potentially dangerous and harmful. There are a couple that have helped modestly a little bit. There are not any big stars that jump out, you know, that are like, wow, this will really help. I think the cinnamon thing has really kind of been way overblown as far as the benefits of that. You know, I don't think there's anything wrong with cinnamon. I don't think it's going to be harmful, but I think you can't really expect it to make
a big... The benefits are very, very modest.
Yeah,
but there are... Fenugreek has been found to have some impact. There's something called Gymnemna sylvestri that's been found to lower blood sugars. In the email today, I got a short description of a study that showed that zinc was helpful to improve glucose control and improve the ability of the pancreas to make insulin. I've never prescribed it. I don't know anything more than just a single study that was reported. But I think the important message is that these should be discussed with a healthcare provider. You should never start something that you think might be, you know, might have heard helps your blood sugars without talking to your doctor or nurse practitioner so that they can look and see if there's any interactions with your standard medications and then watch your blood sugars carefully to make sure that they're not going to make a big difference.
All right, excellent information. Thank you all so much for being here tonight. Great panel, and we so appreciate all of you watching and listening. That's gonna do it for Health Matters tonight. And again, thanks to our panel for a great discussion. Our thanks as well to everyone who emailed and called in. Now join us on April 21st when we will be in the kitchen serving up some healthy and tasty dishes. I'm Teresa Lukens, good night.
Health Matters is made possible by our viewers, the friends of KSBS, and by Providence Healthcare.
I'm Dr. Andrew Boulay, and when my wife had a cardiac arrest, I chose Providence because I knew that everything we needed for her complex care was available, from the emergency room to radiology to the nursing staff to the specialists we needed for her care.
One great thing about working at Providence is that I have the technology and the support for our type of complex patients. I'm Dr. Carl Garabedian, and I chose Providence because here I can provide the highest level of care to children of our region.
Find your doctor online at phc.org.